Hello and welcome to what has turned into an incredibly exciting event tonight with the Cambridge Union. I'm your host, Keir Bradwell, and I'm joined this evening by five incredibly renowned panellists as we discuss what the coronavirus crisis means for education, be that the death of traditional teaching methods or something else entirely. We will, I'm sure, touch on the news that broke yesterday about the University of Cambridge's plans for online lectures in the coming academic year, and I'm delighted that the Vice-Chancellor of Cambridge is joining us tonight. But we also plan to go beyond this, and we have four other panellists this evening who I'm sure will offer an entirely different spin on how coronavirus will affect education long into the future. We'll start by asking each of our panellists tonight to speak for around 5 minutes, and then in the second half of the event, we'll begin a more open discussion between each of us. If you'd like to ask a question to one of our panellists, do leave a comment in the YouTube live chat, and I shall do my best to fit them in. In the meantime, remember to subscribe to the Cambridge Union on YouTube, find us on Facebook, and obviously follow us on Twitter too. With that being said, our first speaker tonight is Shirley Tillman, one of two of our panellists who have led a university. Shirley was president of Princeton University in the US from 2001 until 2013, and is recognised globally as a leader within the scientific community. Shirley, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, and thank you to the Cambridge Union for the invitation to come and have this fascinating discovery with all of you. So I'm going to begin with perhaps is might end up being quite a contrarian position to the question of whether the corona pandemic means the end of traditional education. My short answer is no. For at least the sector of higher education that would include institutions like Cambridge and my own Princeton University. The answer is less clear for more fragile and less resource parts of higher education whose entire business plan is being shattered. But for the purpose of this discussion, I'm going to restrict my comments to the sector that I know best, which I presume is what you meant by the words traditional education. Now, I don't mean for a minute to estimate the seismic impact of this pandemic. This is a serious global public health challenge, to be sure. Certainly the most serious one the world has encountered since the 1918 Spanish influenza pandemic. It's upended every sector of the economy, with the exception perhaps of Amazon and Zoom and my local grocery delivery service. But higher education has not been immune to its upheavals. But I speak not just as a former university president, but as a biomedical scientist. And because of that background, I have confidence that one way or another, through better therapies to reduce the morbidity of the infection, or an effective vaccine, or in the long run, good old-fashioned herd immunity, we will come out of this and life will resume. The time frame is uncertain, but not the ultimate outcome. So why am I so optimistic that Cambridge, as you know it, will resume, possibly even stronger than ever if we play our cards right? First, a bit of historical humility. This event is not a singularity. Universities have faced upheavals of this magnitude for centuries. Even in the modern era, we had two world wars and the Spanish pandemic to contend with without being forced to undertake a radical rethinking of education. Our institutions have survived as long as they have because they are resilient. They're respectful of their history, but they're able to respond nimbly when necessary without losing sight of their mission. Second, the current model has been extraordinarily successful at preparing men and women to lead meaningful, and by that I mean examined, lives. Its central ingredient is the human exchange between tutor and student, the exchange of knowledge, the jousting around for ideas, the testing of intellectual positions that prepare graduates not just for their first job, but for every job they will ever have. As importantly, by living and studying together with others from all over the world, perhaps for the only time in their lives, others whose ethnicity and socioeconomic status and personal beliefs vary wildly from their own, students mature and grow in ways that cannot be easily replicated by other means. Third, one of the drivers of a major change might be a loss of confidence in the value of the product, a degree from institutions like Cambridge and Princeton. I don't see this happening. Graduation from our universities comes with a rare credential that has a consequential value in our society. And I have great difficulty imagining that it will be duplicated by online certificate programs anytime soon. Has traditional education been affected in the short term? Of course. The issue for me is not whether it has been permanently upended, but whether we can learn to make lemonade from the lemons and use this experience to improve the quality of the education that we will provide in the future. The obvious example is the use of information technology to deliver what has been taught much less effectively or efficiently in person in the past, mainly large lecture classes. Right now, I hear from our students that they are not happy with the experience they're having online, and this is hardly surprising. Higher education was slow to fully embrace online learning, especially those institutions that had no financial incentives to do so. So right now we're doing a poor job of delivering online education. If, as I predict, we will be largely online in the fall, we'll be forced to learn how to do this more effectively. And this may finally induce universities to think more creatively about how to deliver online at least some of its education to students who live in residence. But the questions are going to be, when is it optimal to bring students together with faculty? And when is it going to be more effective to use IT? If I can end with just a note that is not so much about education, but the other mission of our research universities, which is the discovery of new knowledge. The challenge of responding to the virus has created extraordinary collaborations and openness, including bypassing the publication juggernaut to get information out as quickly as possible. We've also seen the cutting of red tape to get funds to researchers and expanding the number of funders, including new philanthropists, who are joining together to fund not just vaccine and therapeutics, but basic research into the virus life cycle and the nature of the immune response. Now that the scientific community has discovered the excitement of working together across nations, I'm hopeful that in that case, there will be no turning back to the old ways. I'm going to turn it back to you, Keir.
Thank you very much, Shelley, for those thoughts indeed. And with that in mind, I'd like to turn to another one of our Canadians tonight, Stephen Toop. Stephen is, of course, Vice Chancellor of the University of Cambridge. Stephen, the floor is yours.
Thanks so much, Keir. And I want to start by saying congratulations to the Cambridge Union, one of the world's oldest debating societies, for moving so nimbly into this new era. Well done. And I think that speaks to what is possible. And in many ways, you won't be surprised to learn that I share a lot of the views that Shirley has just put forth. But I will say that I do think there will be tremendous disruption in the system of higher education. And Shirley talked about that right at the beginning. But I think the disruption is likely to be around the need for more diversity across the system. And this is something that I think many people have argued for a long time. There isn't a single model for what a university should be and what students and others need for higher education. So I actually am somewhat hopeful that this crisis, which is really terrible in many ways, will be an impetus for a rethink as to the nature of higher education globally. There's a great piece, if people are interested, written by Martin Lord Rees today in The Times, which makes much of the argument that I would make. So I'll leave that aside. Yes, these are extraordinary, they're difficult times, and there's a huge degree of uncertainty that's going to persist for months, probably even a couple of years. So what have we learned out of this, and what might it mean for a place like Cambridge and other universities, as Shirley described? Well, I think we could start by asking ourselves, why do students come to a place like Cambridge? And I think there's a range of answers to that. Obviously, it's to be taught by some of the leading experts in the world in their chosen area of study, research-led teaching, really, really deep knowledge. But it's also to get to know and be inspired by students, experts, other committed people with tremendous talent who are your co-learners, if I may put it that way. And then finally, of course, for a place like Cambridge, it's to benefit from a unique college experience. small communities with a feeling of belonging. Well, I'm going to suggest that none of that actually has to change fundamentally over the course of the next months and years. Of course, there will be changes, but the fundamentals can remain. So to be really clear, our colleges will remain open and they're going to welcome as many students as possible in October, of course, within public health guidelines. Colleges, I know, are working hard to create new versions of the full student experience, innovative, unexpected experiences, I suspect. I think there are going to be forms of sport and musical performance and, of course, debating. There will also be face-to-face supervisions with social distancing. Our tutors, counselors, nurses, chaplains are going to be on hand to help students with the pressures that they feel. Labs, hands-on learning, performances will all take place with social distancing. And as Shirley suggested, we're all learning to use blended approaches to what used to be the traditional lecture. I actually see that in many ways as a great opportunity, and Shirley really emphasized that as well. We know from neuroscience over many years now that sitting in a big lecture theater and listening to someone rattle on for 50 minutes or an hour or two is not the best way to learn. Now, it's going to be hard to make that transition, and Shirley's right that universities like ours haven't invested a lot in this in the past, but we're going to have to do it now, and we are. We're ramping up our support for our own staff as they have to put materials online, and we're also going to try and upgrade the technology. No, it's not going to be perfect, but I think we have an opportunity to take the best of collegiate Cambridge and to catapult it into the 21st century. I also think that universities are going to continue to matter for the reason that Shirley was emphasizing right at the end. Our research element is now seen to be absolutely crucial by governments around the world. I think there's a recognition that universities are going to be central to the rebooting of economies in the post-COVID era. And by that, I mean participating in the research to innovation chain that's going to be fundamental for economies as they seek new employment possibilities for people. I also think that we're going to do this by producing the brilliant kind of graduates that we have always produced and that will continue to be leaders in fields. And if you think about what's happened over the last few months, universities have become central, as Shirley indicated, to the response to COVID here and now. If you look at incredible work that's being done at sister institutions in vaccine development, we've been working a lot on testing with AstraZeneca and GSK. We have a huge facility just opened on campus. Cambridge's Whittle Lab has developed a low-cost ventilator that's being prototyped right now in South Africa and will allow the Global South to have access to equipment that otherwise wouldn't be there. We're giving advice to government across a whole series of areas. Public authorities are looking to us on privacy issues, on how to reopen schools, on how to support workers who are laid off. All these are real examples of advice that is being sought out. So I think universities clearly are going to have an important role to play in that way. However, I do want to end with a really big worry. I think COVID-19 has shone a light, if it was needed, on educational inequality in this and many other countries. And I do think we're going to see that online provision for students in many privately educated settings has been very strong. And for some in state school sector, but for many, it's been really weak. And I worry that we're going to see unfair outcomes for students who are talented, but are going to be falling behind now and over the next couple of years. We haven't been able to conduct all our outreach efforts in the normal way, but I think universities like Cambridge are going to have to double down. We're going to have to provide enrichment support to students online. We're doing that through Millennium Maths, Isaac Physics, other things. We're going to have to work closely with partners in civil society who help on student attainment in less privileged environments. I suspect Justine may have something to say about that. And we're going to have to redouble our online outreach platforms. We're also going to have to build out our transition year program and bridging programs as quickly as possible. So I would be really sad if this crisis marked a lessening of our constant improvement in encouraging the most talented students to come here, no matter their background. So that's maybe my biggest worry coming out of this, surprisingly.
Thank you very much, Stephen, for those clarifications and contributions. I'd like to turn now to someone who runs a university of a very different kind, Marginal Revolution University. Alex Tabarrok taught me economics through digital means and has co-authored two textbooks and a blog on the matter too, alongside Tyler Cowan. He's also Professor of Economics at George Mason University. Alex, the floor is yours.
Thanks very much. So the title of the debate is, does coronavirus mean the end of traditional education? And of course, the answer to that is no. The way to bet is not what will change forever, but what trends will be accelerated. Now, in the United States in 2017, already, about a third of students were taking at least one online class. And that is going to accelerate. Why? Two reasons. First, online education is cheaper. And second, online education is better. Now, since I'm an economist, let me begin with cheaper. The economics are pretty simple. I can teach 30 students easily, or maybe 300 in a large classroom in a traditional setting. I can easily teach thousands of students online. And that is a massive increase in productivity. Moreover, student learning is about the same in an online class. Sometimes a little bit better, sometimes a little bit worse, depends on the student, but overall, it's about the same as in a traditional class. I wanna put my money where my mouth is and see if I can share my screen here. So let me give you some data. This is a large randomized experiment by Bill Bowen et al, who looked at a statistics class. And they compared the hybrid version of the class with the online version, excuse me, with the traditional version. And what they found is that whether you're looking at the final exam, the online in orange, a post-test, or the pass rate, the online students did a little bit better, actually. So it's not statistically significantly better, but a little bit better. However, the online model was 36% to 57% less costly to run on an ongoing basis than a traditional lecture format. And since the learning outcomes were about the same, what that means is that there's a huge increase in productivity. Productivity goes up by 56% to 133%. So online education can trump the cost disease. Moreover, the hybrid format, the online format students, they learned the same amount of material in a shorter amount of time. So there was a tremendous time savings to those students. And that's not even including the fact that they didn't have to drive to the campus and find a parking spot or not find a parking spot, find the classroom and so forth. Here's another study, this one from Russia, looking at a traditional blended or pure online class, engineering students. Again, whether you're looking at the final exam or assessment, it's about the same, a little bit higher actually for online, but again, not really that much. Student satisfaction, about the same, maybe a little bit lower. That's on the far right here, but really statistically about the same. The big difference, however, is that the online model, the pure online model, was about one quarter the cost. So much, much cheaper. And that includes the cost of creating the course in the first place. So really, online education is the only credible way to reduce costs. And this could be scaled. So Georgia Tech famously has an online master's in computer science. This is a top 10 computer science program in the entire world. The cost is about $7,000, much less than the traditional cost. It has an enrollment of over 3,000 students. It's the largest master's in the world. Now, I want to add to this that the cost savings here, the time savings, are really tremendously important, because a majority of students today are non-traditional students. In my classes, for example, I have many students who have children of their own. We are always giving lip service to this idea of adult education. We say, well, in the 21st century, we need people to continue their education throughout their career, not just for 4 years. It's got to be continuous. The only way to do that is through online education. And this just makes sense. Look, I can get entertainment on demand. Why can't I get education on demand? I can go to Netflix, I can find a film, I can choose when and how I want to watch it, I can pause it, I can rewind it. With video, I can even speed it up or slow it down if I'm having trouble. Okay, why can't I do that with education? Not only is this for non-traditional students, it's also for non-traditional learners. I teach a class at George Mason. It's an online class. It's based upon my textbook with Tyler Cowen, Modern Principles of Economics. It's a modern online class. It contains animations and sounds and music and video and a sophisticated assessment system. What I learned was that a lot of students actually prefer this format. And I want to read you something from from the student evaluations. Quote, I really liked how it was set up with the videos. As someone who is diagnosed with ADHD, this type of online class has made it so much easier for me to constantly go back on videos to hear what the professors were saying and trying to teach us. Honestly, best class experience I've ever had. I wish more were like it. That actually is not alone. Moreover, online education, we're not talking Zoom, okay? Online education is only going to get better. And this is for two reasons. First, online education ties education to a progressive sector, to a sector which is improving, to the tech sector, okay? So every improvement in the tech sector is an improvement in online education. Let me give you an example. The videos which I use, they're all captioned. They're captioned in English, which of course is great for English as second language students. It's also great for the deaf, of course. But in addition, they're captioned in English. They're all translated into Spanish, into Hindi, into Arabic, into Chinese. Those are professional translations. And through machine learning, they're translated into hundreds of different languages, basically every single language that there is, okay? There is no traditional class which has captioning like that. Second reason why online education is only going to get better. If one course can be used to teach 100,000 students who are charged $500, let's say, which is a lot less than they're charged now, then it makes sense to invest $50 per student to produce the course. And that means a $5 million course. Now, there aren't very many professors in the world who can beat a $5 million course. And that's especially true since the $5 million course, it's going to be taught by one of the most brilliant, engaging, charismatic teachers, backed up by a whole team of animators, learning specialists, testers, and so forth. Now, will all education be like this? No, but there is a lot of low-hanging fruit. The large introductory classes, as Shirley mentioned, with hundreds of students, classes in economics, physics, psychology, math, statistics, they can all go online and be better. It is true that education changes very slowly. Universities are among our oldest institutions. Only a few religions are older. But the advantages of online education, it's cheaper and it's better, combined with the pressures of the COVID-19 crisis. Budgets are strained and traditional classroom teaching is dangerous. These are going to accelerate the trend towards online education. Thanks.
Thank you very much for those thoughts and slides, Alex. I would now like to turn to one of our two former Conservative government ministers. David Willetts was Minister of State for Universities and Science from 2010 into 2014 and was made a life peer in 2015. Now he is president of the Resolution Foundation, a think tank that focuses on improving living standards for those on low to middle incomes. David, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much, Kieran, and thanks for the opportunity to join this debate. And they've been three fantastic contributions. And let me try to pull the threads together. First of all, of course, if it's Princeton or Cambridge, and you're thinking of the transition to adulthood that a young person makes, then the opportunity of 3 years at a residential university like that, aged 18, when you're in a kind of semi-adult status and you meet new friends and you operate in a new environment away from the family home, that is fantastic. And that will carry on. But I have to say, when I look to the future of higher education as a whole, I am much more with Alex and what we've just heard. And the reason is that although in Britain we're used to the idea that education, higher education, has already expanded up to almost 50% participation, if you look at it globally, the major expansion is underway now and has got a lot further to go. And if you're sitting in India or South Africa or Brazil, looking at how you can cater for millions more students, I just don't see the capacity to do all the bricks and mortar and the physical building to replicate a Cambridge or Princeton model across these rapidly growing middle income economies. It looks to me that the only way we can organize the resource and deliver education for the millions of new students is online. And secondly, and Alex also made this point, higher education is going to be accessed at lots of different stages of our life. And that special period, aged 18 to 21, is one form of accessing higher education. But when you look at mature students, when you look at people who want to do a master's or some other postgraduate qualification, maybe they left school or college a while back and they need a more vocational master's qualification to advance in their career. The idea for, and they may well have a partner and kids, the idea for them of leaving home to be in some residential environment for a year or 2 years looks absurd. So the growth in all the other forms of access to higher education for those other age groups, I think, has to be online. And the third point, which reinforces some of Alex's arguments, is I think that one of the reasons why online education can be better is the prospect of using data to improve pedagogy. Working out exactly how someone is learning, what they're paying attention to, where they've found difficulties in a course, is much easier and much more powerful if you've got access to every data stroke on their computer. You might even be tracking their eye line to see what they're paying attention to and for how long. Now, there's an ethical debate here, and one of my regrets is the ethical debate on education online data is way behind the ethical debate on health data. There's a lot of issues there which we'd have to park for the time being. But nevertheless, on courses of the scale that Alex is describing, you will have millions of data points. You will be able to see exactly where both individuals have difficulties or where may they make progress. You'll be able to see how learning is happening in a much more detailed way than ever before. So I think a data-driven pedagogy heavily depends on online education. Now, where do universities fit in to this revolution? And there are two different routes we could go. By and large, the digital revolution, when it reaches different sectors, is associated with disintermediation. The middleman gets cut out. The local store gets cut out as we order on Amazon. It'll be fascinating to see whether or not universities get disintermediated in this world. You could imagine one model where you do your online course, you have some kind of online assessment at the end, which has some kind of security check, so you can't just use someone else to complete the course for you. And you put that onto your LinkedIn profile, and on the basis of your LinkedIn profile, you get offered a job because you've got evidence of competency. So you could imagine a world where the traditional university degree is threatened by disintermediation. I personally think, and we don't know, but I personally think that, as Stephen said, universities have got very powerful identities, and probably it's more likely that the university status and brand and reputation is going to be of such value that these online courses are themselves given and associated with named identified universities. That seems to be what's happening already. And indeed, that was Alex's example of Georgia Tech. So in this respect, it'll be unusual. It will be unlike digitization in some other sectors, but it will mean that we can look forward to the day when Cambridge and Princeton and many other universities have many more students than they have at the moment, but they have them online. I do think that's the future.
Thank you very much, David. I'd like to turn now to our final speaker this evening and introduce Justine Greening. She served as Secretary of State for Education under Theresa May following stints at both International Development and Transport. Having left Parliament, Justine now chairs the Social Mobility Pledge. Justine, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. And thanks so much for hosting this debate tonight, which I think is actually a really important one. And I'll give a different take again on this debate, but starting off by saying almost one of the challenges, I think, when you reach an inflection point is that no one's ever more certain of a trend the day before it stops. And so I've always been very conscious of the fact that when change comes, it often happens very quickly, especially when it relates to technology. I'm not going to repeat the arguments that both David and Alex made, but I strongly agree with them that the impact of technology on education is an irresistible force, but also one that we should welcome, because I think it will open up higher education to millions of people who currently find it hard to access. I think what's important to understand in the context of this debate, and if we're looking at does coronavirus mean the end of traditional education, I think the answer is steadily yes, possibly quite quickly yes. And I think the reason for that is because if I look at our own country, Britain, we obviously face a massive opportunity gap that was already there before coronavirus hit Britain. But that gap on inequality of opportunity gets dramatically worse potentially because of coronavirus. So just to put it into context, there will be, it's estimated, around 1 million young people this summer coming into the jobs market from sixth forms and colleges and from higher education. But it's also estimated that only 400,000 of that million will actually get employment. So 600,000 will be leaving our education system without employment. And I think we have to recognize that the debate on higher education will take place against a backdrop of a jobs market that is absolutely brutal for young people in terms of their ability to pursue their paths in life that they had in mind. And it's a generation of young people who will think, hang on a second, I thought I'd already had my problem with the financial crash and the impact that had on budgets and public spending. And now you're telling me, and the impact it ended up cascading through into tuition fees. Now you're telling me we've got another one coming on the back of it. And actually, I'm a young person and I can't remember a time when we weren't in some kind of financial crisis now. So I think young people will really demand, quite rightly, a lot more from governments and universities and businesses in terms of stepping up to the plate to fix that opportunity crisis that they will face. But I also think that there will be an inevitable view on how can we help those young people that are perhaps the furthest away from having a level playing field and opportunity, and those that are going to be most disadvantaged by the crisis that is coming down the track. And I think that's, in a sense, why you'll start to see a shift, because there will be almost a political focus on this. But I think also there will be a business focus on this too. And I think businesses more seized than ever before of its wider role in society. So there are many companies in the UK now who have a financial relationship with the taxpayer. They didn't intend for it to happen. They probably almost certainly never wanted it to happen, but they now are bound up with the state in a way they've never been before. And that will change how they look at the way in which they operate. And I think we've talked about trends being fast-tracked. And I think the other trend I really wanted to talk about today is almost the trend for businesses to look beyond their short-term bottom line being fast-tracked. And in a sense, what we're seeing are trends that might have taken 5 to 10 years to play out, whether it's technology or anything else, suddenly hitting us all in about 5 to 10 months. But I think for companies, it is really going to be an interesting journey that they're on, because almost out of sight of the education system is a growing shift of companies to take a different approach to how they look at what they value in staff they bring into their businesses. And they have moved away from a traditional education system already, but I think the education system perhaps hasn't quite appreciated maybe how crucial this shift is. So what they've done is they've steadily moved away from a system that helps young people build up academic capital to far more balance up the almost capability capital that young people have. And I'll demonstrate this with two examples with employers that I've spoken to pretty recently, actually. I must have talked to 200 plus employers about this, who were all part of the Social Mobility Pledge campaign. One of them was one of the major accounting firms, and they told me that they wanted to improve their recruitment. And so the obvious thing to do is look at who's successful in your company at every level, find out what they've got in common, and then re-engineer your recruitment process to locate those people more effectively. They do that work, and shockingly for a former education secretary, they discover that there is zero correlation with academic attainment. The three things that they found that they then re-engineered their processes around for recruitment were the following. Their most successful employees had all had adversity in their early lives that they had had to confront and deal with. They had all, interestingly, had a paper round, a Saturday job, some kind of paid employment from an early age. And they could all readily talk about a team that they'd been in that had achieved something. In other words, they were people who were resilient, they were people who were motivated, and they were people who were able to be a team player. And we all know that if you're going to achieve anything in life, you have to work with other people. What was interesting was, actually, I'll come back to the managing partner's view on this in a second. The second discussion I had that really struck me and kind of tells you where the fault lines are emerging, was with a very well-known fund manager that is really shaping lots of debates and is absolutely at the center of how investors are looking at sustainable financial returns. They told me that they would not take anybody into their business with a master's in fund management. And at that moment, sat in my then parliamentary office, My mind inevitably flicked to a whole load of master's students studying a master's in fund management, thinking that it would get them a job with this very company, but not realizing that that was this company's attitude. And what they said to me when I asked them how that was the case was that they could teach them anything they needed to know about the markets. What they couldn't teach these people that they were looking for was the kind of capability on resourcefulness, on initiative, on motivation, all these things actually that the accounting and professional services managing partner had said to me. He finished off telling me this story of how they'd re-engineered their recruitment process about 3 years ago by saying he went back home to his wife that weekend and said, "We've got a problem. Our children are having a wonderful upbringing with no adversity, and we're well off, and so they don't need to have a job or anything. Our kids are not going to get through this process I've just put in place for our blue chip, wonderful professional services firm. What are we going to do?" And I thought it was a really good challenge. But in a sense, the reason I say all of this is because you can almost see, I'm being provocative here to generate a debate. You can almost see a bit of a perfect storm if you're not careful. So courses move online. And actually, as we've heard, online is better. And if Alex shows the UK Treasury those slides, as David will confirm, there'll be all sorts of issues with tuition fees going on in the UK. But then if you match that to almost a customer group, employers saying, well, we're less focused on the academic capital, we're much more focused on capability capital, then you end up with them going to actually quite different places. And so I'll controversially say, if you're a university that is strong in academic capital, you're sort of where employers used to be, you're not where they're going to. So, and if you're a university that maybe was very focused on connections, then actually that gets disrupted too, because if your students aren't milling around one another, then actually the way they form those connections at any university gets disrupted, and it's increasingly also going to be something that they previously got from a higher education experience, as I did, that moves online. And I think allied to that then is almost the skill set change, which is, you know, maybe being able to do a nice bit of small talk with your boss before a meeting, before you go into the meeting room, that disappears if everyone's on Zoom like we are. What matters in a Zoom economy and a Zoom business world is whether you're able to get your points across really punctually. Actually, people don't really care who you know at that stage. And I think I'm sort of throwing some of these thoughts out there because actually I think in a way that's maybe the bigger challenge for all universities. And so not only will they, I think, have a challenge of explaining what they're doing to close the opportunity gap, and I think universities like Cambridge are obviously going to be looked at in that context. And I should say in all of this, I really welcome the steps that both Oxford and Cambridge have made in recent years to widen participation. I think they're really welcome and I think they're really important for the institutions. And I think they've actually shown some leadership to a wider HE sector. But I think the points I'm making are just my observations from talking to employers that are out there. And at the end of the day, getting a degree is an amazing experience. Going to university absolutely transformed my own life, including the social capital and the capability capital that I'd be built up whilst I was there. But actually, I guess most students are doing it for a reason, and that's to give them a springboard to a career and a job. And I think almost as that job market's tightening and as the opportunities are becoming almost more looked at from an equity perspective, and as employers change their attitudes to how they more strategically look at their role and opportunity, then I think there's a challenge to universities, but I think it's a positive one. And it's something I think that the higher education sector should embrace. And I think diversity of thought is what businesses are looking for. And it's increasingly going to be important for universities too.
Wonderful. Thank you, Justine, very much for that indeed. That brings us to the end of the first part of our event this evening. And we're now going to turn to what will hopefully be a broader discussion between our panellists tonight. But before we do that, I'd like to cover a couple of the questions from our YouTube live chat. There have been quite a few, so apologies if you're watching and yours hasn't been picked. But one of the first things I'd like to look at is something Amy touches on in terms of the distributional impacts of the coronavirus crisis. She asks, what is being done to ensure that online education is accessible to all, regardless of personal circumstance? Has thought been given to students with sufficient resources? And I wonder whether it might also be worth bringing in issues around people with various different mental health needs and how they might interact with a future of online education too. Now, I'm not sure who wants to take that, but I will leave that open to the floor and anyone can feel free to jump in. Feel free to speak. I think you're unmuted, then you can speak now.
In the absence of anyone else responding, I just want to come back to a point that Stephen made that I think is absolutely critical. One of the things we're finding is that this epidemic is exacerbating inequality in the receipt of education, no matter where you are. but certainly we are finding that there are students who are simply incapable of continuing to participate in the semester simply because there is absolutely no ability for them to be in a room by themselves at home, or they do not have good wireless connections and so on. So I think this is a profound issue that is going to haunt efforts to expand online education, that while we are doing so remotely, I do think Stephen is absolutely right. We're exacerbating the inequalities that we already know exist among our student body in terms of their socioeconomic status. I don't have a good solution for this right now, but I think I completely share Stephen's concern that this is one of the things we are all most worried about.
Could I just add a point about the developing world? Because I completely agree, of course, that technology's got to be part of the solution in a wider distribution of educational opportunity. There's no debate about that. But we also can't overestimate the progress that's already been made here. There are many parts of the world, and I've visited them, where there is no internet access and where there's barely stable electricity for a radio or a television. So we're not going to leap over this in the next 4 or 5 years. Now, of course, these people don't have access to great universities either. But, you know, there's a lot of promise here, but there also has to be a huge infrastructure investment to make a reality out of online education, just as there has been in making a reality out of in-person education. And we can't underplay that. And it's not going to happen that quickly in a moment when we see tremendous economic challenge in front of so many societies. So, you know, just cautionary note on how much we can deliver quickly enough.
I'll speak very briefly to that. There are temporary problems. However, in terms of increasing access to education, online again is really the only way to do it. It's not perfectly distributed all over the world, but over a billion people or so in India have a cell phone. And soon most of them will be smartphones. So the access to online education is increasing much, much faster than with other technologies, because everybody wants to be online, if not for education, at least for Netflix. And so that is just driving the technology, which has expanded in the developing world much, much faster than any previous technology. Many more people in India have access to a cell phone than have access to piped water, for example.
I think the other point is, I think it's really well made, and I think it highlights the digital divide, and it makes it much more important to almost policy-wise look at the impact of that and take steps to fix it. And I think it just simply changes what our expectations are on what children have. You know, we never expect kids to go home without a textbook or an exercise book to write on. I think we're rapidly getting to a point where we will expect the same on a laptop or an iPad. I also think it's worth bearing in mind that, you know, there's an implicit assumption that there won't be a COVID 20, 21, 22, 23. And I think all governments, and indeed, I guess, institutions that are higher education institutions, will need to think about a resilience strategy. And having people teched up to be able to participate, whether they're, you know, at the university or at home, I think will be an important part of how we make sure the digital divide doesn't make gaps that are already there any worse. Final point is, you know, we talk a lot about the home learning environment, and as Alex and David have both said, I think that our strategy around what good home learning environment and good online learning looks like will transform. I also think it'll have to transform for home working. And we need to recognize that some people will be able to perform better in their careers if they've got spaces to work in that are quiet. And so this is gonna cascade through, I think, a lot of our lives over time, but we'll confront it like we do any challenge.
I have some other related questions about soft skills and whether or not there are aspects to higher education that might be missed out by moving online. Viola asks, do you think it is justified to make decisions about education mainly based on the cost of running the programs and students' grades? I think that's aimed at Alex. And I think Mark's sort of question for Stephen, which is, How will students be able to have a Cambridge experience while still social distancing? A treasured part of the college experience is eating together. How can this be done in this context? And I wondered if either of you might talk about the kind of other elements that we might be missing by moving online.
Sure, let me say a few words. This is how I think about these kinds of issues, because a lot of people say, well, there's something magical about the in-class experience. I think as Shirley said, with the tutor, of course, most of us don't get tutors, but let's go over that anyway. Here's the thing, we see exactly the same thing is true with music, right? So in 1985, I got to see the soul singer Otis Clay in a bar in Toronto, and it was a defining cultural experience. It was a fantastic night. I remember it even today. However, 99.9% of the music which I consume is recorded music. Why is that? Well, the recorded music, of course, is much cheaper. It's much more easily accessible anywhere in the world today. I can get the absolute very best. I can get the best Mozart symphony recording. I could get it much cheaper. I could get it much more easily. And most live music is not that good. It's just not as good. It's not as good as what I can get recorded. There are heights. The heights are amazing. You know, like I said, Otis Clay, 1985, the heights are fantastic. But most of it, it's not worth the time and the trouble to go out to the club. I'll be disappointed. It'll cost me $100. I got to pay for parking, you know, and the food will be bad, whatever. It's not going to be that good, which is why most of us consume recorded music. And I think the same will be true of education. Of course, there's room at the top universities for the tutor model, and we're going to need that for, you know, hands-on science and things like that. But there's a big room for a tailored online experience, which can be better than the traditional model.
Maybe I'll come in. Look, I don't disagree with any of that. I think it makes perfect sense in certain contexts. I think essentially we have to avoid a whole series of false dichotomies here. So this isn't about traditional versus online. Traditional has to learn from online. I think that's one of the things Shirley was really emphasizing at the beginning. We can do better if we actually learn from the digital experience and deliver better opportunities for our own students. But the other piece to your question is, I think, a false dichotomy between academic and capability. I think they often overlap. And one of the great experiences of being, I mean, Justine said her university education was transformative. And that is the common word that you hear from people. It is transformative if you're lucky. It isn't for everybody. But when it is, it's because you've blended the academic and the capability. You've learned how social intercourse actually happens. You've had to debate with people who come from different backgrounds, who have different ideas. You've had to work in teams together to build a project if you're an engineer. You've had to do all sorts of things that actually do build capabilities. So I think there are different ways of accomplishing these goals. And I think essentially what we're saying is we need all of them. My worry is we could, in doing that and creating greater differentiation, which I agree with and think is right, we have to be careful we're not reinforcing social exclusion by giving only some people the access to the really great personal experience, and everybody else gets something that is good from a learning perspective in terms of knowledge acquisition, but may not do anything else for them.
Fantastic. Well, I'd like to turn very quickly now, we haven't got long left, but I'd like to know what you all thought of each other's brief speeches at the beginning and see if you had any questions for one another. And perhaps it might be best to start back at the beginning and find out, Shirley, if there's anything you'd like to ask one of our other panelists. She may be muted. Okay. In which case we can move on. In which case, perhaps I ought to ask Alex, is there anything you'd like to know around any of our other panelists? Anything you'd like to ask anyone? I don't know if we can hear you actually at the moment. So that's...
how's that? Am I back?
That's better. Yeah, there we go.
Okay.
Perfect.
All right. So my apologies. So I'm going to poke Stephen and Shirley just a little bit. I apologize, but I'm going to cause a little trouble. I agree with them. You know, Cambridge and Princeton are going to be fine. You know, Cambridge, I think, is like 22,000 students, Princeton 6,000, something like that. But there are 22 million students in the United States. And so I want to ask Stephen and Shirley for the non-Princeton, non-Cambridge students, what to give some idea of where do they think online plays for those students outside of the elite?
Does Shirley want to go first?
I'm happy to go first. I'm worried about my internet connection. All of you are going in and out a great deal at the moment. If you can't hear me, let me know.
We can.
Can you
hear? Yes, we're fine. Yes.
No. That may be famous last words.
Okay, well, then I'll continue. So, you know, I think one of the great difficulties great difficulties in having a broad conversation about higher education is that
emblematic of some of the difficulties of learning online, perhaps. Might it be worth pretending to Stephen and hoping that Shirley's internet connection improves at some point, and then we may have time to come back?
Well, as I tried to say, I actually think there's no dichotomy here. I agree that there has to be excellent online provision for students to have access for a lot of the reasons Alex and David and Justine have emphasized. There are some who can't go into residential opportunities, who couldn't afford it, who are looking for something different. So I'm really supportive of a wide variety of opportunity being presented to students. My concern is that we don't by accident undermine institutions that are offering something different simply because we're excited about these new online opportunities. I think they have to play out together and they serve different functions.
Perfect. I wondered perhaps if David might want to ask a question of one of our other panelists and see if it's anything he thought was particularly interesting.
Yeah, I mean, a couple of questions really for some, you know, fantastic fellow panelists. Two observations, really. I mean, first, if you look at how the digital revolution plays out, you begin by doing things digitally the same way as you've done them traditionally. And then you start realizing you can use digital methods to do things differently. And actually, I think one of the dangers for ed tech and online education is we think it's a lecture and a seminar on Zoom or Teams. I'm interested in where this goes. I'm interested in innovation in pedagogy. I think one of the challenges is creating a sense of community when students are studying online. And Alex has already given some interesting empirical evidence. And there's some evidence coming in that you can also create online communities and a sense of teamwork. And you can confront moral issues in professional training by role playing. But I think the challenge for online education is to show it's not just doing things on Zoom, with the greatest respect to Zoom this evening. And I'd be interested in observation, especially from Alex on that. And then secondly, just I think there's a group we haven't talked about at all that we at Resolution Foundation are most worried about. And that is this year's education leavers. It is an immediate crisis for them. These are people whose last months and terms of education have been disrupted and who are entering a jobs market that is the worst possible jobs market they could face, as Justine said. And if I was looking for an area for experiment and innovation, we desperately need, and we've publicly called on our Department for Education in Britain to do it, we need a kind of education innovation fund for what we offer to school, college and university leavers basically for the next 6 months so that they get, and it'll probably be mainly online but needn't be exclusively online, because they're either going to be claiming universal credit on £95 a week, having been let down through no one's fault in the last months of their education, or we offer them something better to do. And I would like to see a shared effort to create some rapid online extra education and training programs for this group. There are We estimate a resolution between 600,000 and 800,000 of them in the UK. Obviously, I think a similar phenomenon in other advanced Western countries. That's the group I most worry about. And I think we have a particular obligation to them, which at the moment we're not discharging.
I'll say a few words about the first issues that David raised. I agree completely. Online communities can be tremendously tight and tremendously rewarding. I think most of us find the difficulty is the opposite. It's getting off online. You know, we're all on Twitter, right? And tweeting all the time because it's just so rewarding in some ways to be part of these online communities. So I think that problem of creating community is already been solved by, you know, the Facebooks, by the Twitters and so forth. And we just need to adopt some of that to education. I agree completely that the future is very open and is definitely not just giving sort of lectures. That's very boring. You could do a lot more. And whether it's going to be, you know, I could think about virtual worlds, the way we have with gaming. I think if you want to see what the future of education is going to look like, look first to games, because they put a lot of investment in it. So these online worlds like EVE Online, an entire universe, and you could do a lot of education within that universe, like simulations, like living, for example, if you're a city planner, SimCity. But what about if you actually put somebody into a world and then ask them, okay, what are you going to plan? What are you going to do? Or, you know, you're a epidemiologist and you put them into a simulation, a worldwide simulation. And okay, you get to impose a lockdown over here, or here you get to lift the lockdown. And you can see in real time in the simulated world what happens and make adjustments. So I absolutely agree with David that this is a huge opportunity to make education much more vivid, much more real, much more applied than it ever has been before. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. I wondered then if we could turn then to Stephen to see if he had any questions for any of our other panelists. You are muted.
Let me pick up just a couple of issues. First off, I want to say that one of the funny things that's been happening, I know with a lot of our students, is they are actually building virtual colleges, their own colleges using software. Yeah. That tells me something, though. It says that there's a certain resonance with the college that they want to replicate. And it goes to this question that you've just raised about creating community. Yes, of course. I mean, we all know about online communities and the strength that they can have. And they open up opportunities for people who could never meet to engage. Lots of great things about it. But we also have to look at some of the data, which is telling us that there are greater senses of social isolation, and that has been exacerbated in this lockdown. There are greater mental health challenges emerging amongst people who feel that sense of isolation, even though they have access to all of the online. So again, we can't make this either or. Clearly, people need both. They need the online experience, and they also need something that allows them to express themselves fully as human beings in person to person relationships. And I think that, you know, that's always been one of the great strengths of what we're calling here traditional models of education. And I think we just want to make sure we don't denigrate those as we try to uphold the great new opportunities that online education also provides. Not really a question, I apologize.
I've noticed Shirley's back now, so I wondered if we would be able to circle back and ask her for her comments earlier that were sadly cut off by her connection, if it's improved. Okay, we're getting an expression that I don't think things have improved. Does that work? No. Oh, okay. Okay, well, in which case, we would appear to have overrun slightly.
I'm not sure you can hear me right now, but I'm gonna leave the conversation because I just keep going in and out. I'm afraid I live in a third world country.
Okay, well, I think that's okay. I think we probably ought to use that as an excuse to bring our discussions to an end anyway, as we seem to have slightly overrun, which is my fault. I'd like to thank all of our panelists for being here this evening, as well as our viewers at home for watching. Wherever you are, I hope you stay safe and preferably stay at home. We've got lots more exciting events coming up at the Union listed on our Facebook page to keep you occupied in the meantime. So that's all from us. Thank you all very much and good night.
Thank you. That was fun.
Thank you very much. Appreciate Thanks. It. Well organized. Nice to see all of you.
Problems. That's a minor miracle.
Good luck with all your work.
Good talking with you all.
Take care.
Great. Thanks. See you guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye.